Yes, please.
Okay, so welcome everyone.
Yeah.
There's the camera, anyway. So welcome everyone, we're in a hybrid noon meeting and I'm very pleased that Dr. Ntsiki Mapukata can present her PhD work, which has got very good reviews. And it's on a topic that I'm afraid is an old, I don't know what to say favorite, because it's not a favorite, it's just an old, very persistent challenge in our health system about rural workforce. When Duma Bakra was here, we were teaching students about rural health, and that was decades ago, and the problems seem intractable. So maybe see you can share with us her PhD and find some solutions. Talking about habitus.
Thank you. Thanks, Leslie. So the topic is making a rural workforce, exploring the habitus of health sciences students from rural South Africa. So I flipped my slides and I'm starting with acknowledgements. So the study would not have been possible without the class of 2020, students of rural origin, my supervisors, Professor Manderson and Professor Reed, the UCT Research Office for the funding, and also the school for the leave and support from colleagues and head of school and head of division. And of course, this is a journey that started in 2005 when I joined VETS, the Center for Rural Health, under the leadership of Professor Poop and colleagues. And I was responsible for a wire scholarship program. So we were supporting students of rural origin. And we also had other initiatives that looked at addressing the challenges of human resources, particularly in rural areas in South Africa. I am grateful to my family, to friends, my children, and also PhD warriors. So these are women and men who have provided support through this journey. But as I approach this topic, I draw from Victor Hugo, who says there is always more misery among the lower class than there is humanity in the higher. And as I am about then to present, I do want to say to those who are on this journey, so Mulela for joining me. And I do also want to declare my positionality as a person of rural origin, born and bred, educated there. And so I started this journey by reflecting on who I am, where I grew up, and what I was exposed to. And then as I joined an institution of higher education, I then had to center a Black narrative and look at the role of a higher education institution and how it facilitates transforming habitus. So that paper is in press. And so for today, in terms of the outline, I'll provide context, I'll look at literature, I'll speak to habitus and the conceptual framework, speak to methodology, findings, conclusions, recommendations, and policy review. I do have a lot of slides, so I do need you to journey with me. I'm not going to read all of them. This is a qualitative study, so there's a lot. And so I've highlighted some text. Green is positive. Purple is supposed to be red, but it's not. But in terms of context, so in rural South Africa, a third of South Africa's citizens reside there. And according to the World Bank, there is also no definition of rural areas. At the minimum, they are presented as complex, dynamic and heterogeneous. But what we find is that the schools are poorly resourced, with some students, particularly in the SMK and Bombo, still learning under the trees. And then for this study, if you are of rural origin, I'm speaking to students who were born and bred in South Africa. And then for health sciences students, which are the main focus for this study, these are students who register for professional degrees in the Faculty of Health Sciences and exit with a professional degree registered with the HPCC. Now, in terms of context, so if you're talking about the health workforce, we know that, there is a chronic shortage of healthcare workers. This is a global concern, but particularly for rural areas, this is extended, and we speak of challenges, for instance, in attaining the Millennium Development Goals 4, 5, and 6, where we know that maternal and child mortality rates are still very high, and we have not been able to eradicate TB, HIV, and STIs. And so that remains an obstacle still with the sustainable development goals. And in the rural areas, this shortage is compounded by this maldistribution of the workforce. There is a challenge both in attracting and in retaining healthcare workers. And this is in fact related to context and geographical and environmental factors, such that there is now this call for a shift from social determinants of health to looking at environmental determinants of health. This is in Australia, and rural determinants of health here in South Africa. So we know that COVID had an impact, and there is again that paper from the Academy of Science where they are predicting that it's going to disrupt gains that were made previously, particularly in managing conditions such as HIV and TB. So we do have to look at the South African reality. We know that in South Africa, pre-1994, access to higher education institutions was stratified along racial lines. And in fact, Philip Tobias spoke of a 30-year training deficit, particularly for blacks and colors in Southern Africa. And if we're looking at that, we only are left with a few months before we get to 2023. So, his prediction were true. And unfortunately, he's late, but he's someone who cared a lot about students. So there was a mandate to higher education institutions to address the inequalities, to ensure that there was equitable access to higher education institutions. But particularly for medical schools and the Faculty of Health Sciences, there was a directive for them to accept a diverse group of students, facilitate learning outcomes that were congruent with place, and also adopt curricula that will respond to the needs of particular communities. And so we had black students, many of them, but we didn't know who they were until the fees must fall 2015, 2016, and the reality was realized in 2017. And so that call that was made then by the World Health Organization, reviewed recently, the National Department of Health, the Lancet Commission, it's founded on a premise that empirical evidence supports that students of rural origin will go back to their communities to practice, but that has not considered everything that happens in those spaces. So contextual factors, for instance, were not looked into in planning for healthcare provision, and the provision that was introduced in as a policy framework for community service, both for medical doctors and also for health and rehab practitioners, it also has revealed an apathy for rural areas, such that only 16% have been retained. And in fact, even for rehabilitation therapists, there are challenges that are reported by Ned et al. In Tuari. Beyond that, we have a highly feminized workforce, and also we do have a twin pandemic in the form of gender-based violence. So despite then these mandates, policies, a pipeline approach that assumes that if you bring in rural students, you will have rural health practitioners at the end. The Lancet Commission that motivated for strengthening health systems and required institutions, in fact, to approach learning in a multidisciplinary ways. We still have an estimated shortage of 30 million by 2030, as estimated by the World Health Organization. And this is likely going to affect low middle income countries, so the Africa region in particular. And so with that, there's an interest in understanding the lived experiences of health sciences of rural origin. And so my research question then was, how does habitus influence the professionalization of finally health sciences students from South Africa? So I wanted to understand the lived experiences of those students, determine the influence of the learning environment as these students adapt to become health professionals. And I had four objectives. So looking at how they transitioned from home to school to university, the role of the university in their continuation, and also how they become healthcare professionals. And then ultimately, I will present the different forms of capital that they had access to. So I'm looking at a social constructivism approach, and that is, or rather was made popular by Pierre Bourdieu, but it was not his initial idea. It was conceptualized by Aristotle and linked to a moral framework and virtual character. So it had biblical connotations then. But when you think about habitus, so as you have seen, I've been playing around with this rubber band. This represents habitus. It's who we are, what we do. It has a community perspective, according to Navarro. It's a product of history that is capable of producing both individual and collective practices. So you could be an individual, but you could also be influenced by others. But it speaks to also the influences that are gendered, class-based, ethnicity, culture, and level of education. And it's also an outcome of both subjective and objective experiences. And you will see as I present my findings. And again, it's durable, but it's not fixed. But it's transposable across different contexts and different places. And so in terms of the conceptual framework, then I draw from Pierre's framework, where habitus and capital informs practice. But for this study, I was interested in this interplay between socialization, experience, and professional practice, looking at students of rural origin who were educated in rural areas. So if one is looking then at the forms of capitals and that one has access to, the social capital. So these are resources that one has access to through their networks. It can be bonding forms, within existing groups. It can be bridging where you create new relationships, or it could be linking where you're trying to establish new links. And then the symbolic capital. So if you think about the chair of the Health Sciences Student Council, that's somebody who's going to have that prestige on the basis of the position that they occupy. And then you have three forms of cultural capital. So these are institutionalized forms in the form of qualifications, awards, and also embodied forms. So knowledge, the way we speak, style, taste, and then possessions as an objectified form. And then you have, lastly, the economic capital as assets that are convertible into money or property rights. Okay, then in terms of the field, when you're looking at the field, this will be an institution, a school or a workplace where cultural capital is generated. And there you have actors who perform, so yourselves. You also have agents, administrators who exert rules and power. And then the university itself is responsible for generating both academic and scientific capital. And then, of course, we have the rules. So in terms of the methodology, so as I said, this is a qualitative study. I used a purpose-driven sampling approach because I wanted to look at students from rural South Africa, not just the Western Cape. And because we're in a COVID era, so I ended up having in-depth interviews on MS Teams. There were 21 participants who agreed to participate. My target was 30. I also had in phase two general reflections where they had to reflect on a particular block in a particular discipline. I used the collective case design approach because I was interested both in the individual experience and the collective, and also looking at contextual comparison, exploring causal relationships. And of course, ultimately, I wanted to look at a theoretical framework. So for my participants, I had invited them to tell their story. And also, these are students who are registered for the 5 professional degrees in the Faculty of Health Sciences at UCT. So that would be audiology, medicine, occupational therapy, physiotherapy, and speech language pathology. And when I started this journey, I knew that 30% of the 2020 class, 369 students, were of rural origin. But because I could not, I could only interview 5 students face to face, and the latter, the bulk of them, the 16, I had to tap into the institutional repository database because there was COVID. And I then discovered that only 7% of that class were students of rural origin. The others that I approached were upset, because they didn't want to be associated with rural areas. And because the study was conceptualized at first, so I had two sets of ethics approval. And I also had to debrief my participants, because when I did my pilot, both at VETS and here at UCT, they said that these were going to be difficult conversations. So I decided that at the end of each interview, I would debrief. But I mean, there is, so it's not really something that I invented. Test says that it's important to do that because it fulfills three functions, particularly when you are dealing with vulnerable groups. So I had an ethical and ethical duty to do that. Also from a methodological function in the pre-test phase, I needed to understand what were the issues with my approach and whether they were comfortable. And there is, of course, an educational function in terms of closing gaps and also understanding issues of concern. But this part of the interview was not recorded. In analyzing my data, I used Saldana's four-phase approach. So I moved from phrases, common words, to narratives that merged into patterns and themes. And one of the participants, in fact, at the end of the interview, she said that this was 90 minutes of free therapy. So because rural areas are ill-defined, I started by asking them to tell me about their definition of rural origin, because these were self-identifying students. I didn't prescribe to them, I didn't tell them, and I wanted also to understand this diversity of rural contexts. And so three things emerged from that. There were demographic factors, there were social factors, and there were also educational factors. So in terms of the demographic profile, the majority of my participants were studying medicine. They were from KwaZulu-Natal, and so they spoke isiZulu. But many of my participants were actually multilingual, not necessarily limited to English, multilingual in the context of South Africa, so they could speak other languages. And seven of the nine provinces were represented, so we were only missing Mpumalanga and the Northern Cape. And the majority were female. I mean, as you know, there is this feminization, which is in fact a balance of forces, because if you think back to the history of medicine, everything was about men, and then nurses were in delegated roles. So but for two programs here, OT and speech and language pathology, there were only female participants. And only four of those participants lived with both parents. And this is not a bad thing, according to Hall and Sambo. They say that it does not mean that the students are abandoned. You know, lives are complex. It may be convenient, you know, for someone to live with the grandparents if their mother or father is working somewhere else. And so in terms of that profile then, the students, they said, or rather the participants, they identified demographic factors as one of the concerns. And they spoke of an old infrastructure, something, you know, that was constructed many years ago with only the main road. And also they said that a rural area is a place where there is no automated teller machine and no central business district. It has a proper gravel road. And in fact, they established a causal link between poverty, unemployment, and impassable roads. And then with regards to health, they said health was inaccessible and also unavailable. But now looking at social factors, communities were places where their identity was validated, they were greeted, they were acknowledged. So it meant that they exist. So if you're looking at that paper by Dichaba, it means that someone is acknowledging you and is interested in you as a human being. And then home was a place where family values were established. And again, if you think about habitus, the primary habitus is a responsibility of the family and extended family members. And so they also had readily access to ancestors, and they could practice cultural traditions like coming of age ceremony, and also could access divine protection. So, I mean, this context then of being greeted is one that resonated with many of my participants. And one, in fact, was particularly upset because she said she would go to Pick and Pay expecting the cashier to greet her and, you know, have conversation. And she said, where she comes from, the cashier would say, my baby, how are you? So there was then that resonance in a village where everybody knows you. But they also spoke of the intrusive nature of those communities, because everybody is interested in your business. And then further to that, they spoke of social attributes that meant that they were caring and compassionate. And they referred to church as a place that provided anchor and a sense of belonging. And so if you look at the values that they speak of, those are founded from church principles and them participating as teachers, as advocates, and also as participants who were already having an innate need and sensitive to the needs of others to help. And then looking at educational factors, this is where there were challenges. And so if one is looking at the theory by Bordeaux and Passeron, they say that in the absence of an intervention, students of rural areas are not likely to accumulate cultural capital. And so for my participants, they spoke of having to cross a river to go to school. And I mean, in this one instance, the one didn't have a raincoat, so they were vulnerable to environmental elements. And it meant that some of them would miss school, you know, on a particular day or a week if it was raining heavily. And we know that for some students, in fact, they get lost in that process. You know, they lose shoes, they lose books, and that is the end of their career. And the other thing that was significant about the schools that they went to is that they lacked basic amenities. So there were no computers, no library. And in fact, Ntsiki says that more than about 40% of schools do not have libraries, and we assume that they are there. And many of the participants were changing schools, trying to find the right school. Some spoke of changing as many as 4 times, but in all of that, they were supported by family members and their principals. So for the first objective then, I wanted to understand their transition from home to school. And 3 themes emerged from this. There was an aspirational habitus, you know, to become. So some said they have always dreamed of becoming, you know, doctors mostly, because they came to the city thinking they could all do medicine, mostly. But there was also a vision by their teachers and family members, and some spoke of a destiny. And one participant spoke of healing hands that were identified by the father. There's also disorientation and adaptation. So looking at the levels of disorientation, it was really because they were in an environment that was new. They wanted to be far away from home, but they did not understand that it would have an impact. They would have no support. They would be isolated. And one speaks of, you know, her accent as a colored person, where he assumed that all colored people would speak the same way as he. And I mean, it was a shock of his life when it was not the case. English was the main disruptor. It silenced them, it muted them. It meant that they could not participate in activities because they did not trust their voices. And in fact, this is not a concept that is new. So in a study that I did at VETS, participants, they also said that it took them 4 years to find their voices in a classroom setting, but then in a small group setting, it would take about 6 months. So these participants also exhibited similar. And this was not limited to first year. It extended also to the clinical spaces. So for instance, this participant speaks of experiences in third and fourth year. So these are students who were top achievers in their schools. They were big fish in small ponds, and they came into a context where there were small fish in a big pond. Now, if you understand anything about language, we know that there's power in the language, and there's a symbolism, there's a tone that is acceptable, and you find that at times you are rejected. So in trying to moderate then their experiences, they decided, you know, some would wear they put a stethoscope around their neck, wear a white coat, put on scrubs. But for this particular participant, she discovered that in fact, that came with an additional responsibility because members of the public assumed that she was certified, so she had to disrobe. There were participants who really had painful experiences. So for instance, if you're looking at this one, she was in private accommodation, stayed in a dingy place in Salt River. She speaks of being hungry, but could not join. Her peers in the canteen did not have money and did not fit in, was alone, and had to go for, you know, additional support. So in that context, this participant and many others, in fact, they were vulnerable, prone to mental health challenges, but they were also resilient. And ultimately, for some of them, they ended up in the intervention program. But what is interesting about that space is that they say it was a space where there was a lot of stigma. It felt like you had a virus of some sort. You were isolated. But it was also a space where they could come together with others and share something that was common. In adjusting to the UCT culture, they felt like imposters, you know, because some of them had never had encounters with white people. They've never had a white lecturer. But there was also this contention where the peers assumed that, you know, they were here because of affirmative action or BE, but in fact did not have the results for them to belong. So there is one participant, for instance, who speak of being a high achiever, who was celebrated, you know, for representing the Black students, but then frowned upon, you know, by the others because they didn't understand how she got in. So this then resulted in tensions and shifts. And in fact, throughout this study, there are tensions and shifts, but there's also intrinsic motivation for these participants. There's this aspirational habitus where they are clear on who they want to be and what they want to achieve. But they spoke of navigating these two platforms, being who they are, being afraid of losing their identity. So they speak of living in two worlds at the same time. And then in terms of faculty support, so this was provided at four levels. There was academic, emotional, financial, and social support. So they had mentors, they had computers, and this one said she had never seen a computer and had to admit that, she could also not use a computer. But she is grateful that digital literacy was integrated into the curriculum. And then they also speak of the manager who was a lifesaver who supported them. But financially, there were a lot of challenges. And this had an impact on their mental health. And I mean, one participant in particular had to work at a supermarket back at home. And she was saying, I wonder if people know that I study anatomy. I'm here, you know, working as a cashier because I need the money. So in terms of their coping strategies, then they had their own strengths. They had the intrinsic motivation. They were resilient. They had a passion for rural health. But with regards to their weaknesses, they were vulnerable because they didn't have the resources. They came from rural backgrounds, so there were linguistic challenges. They were prone to discriminatory practice and mental health challenges. But they were motivated intrinsically so. You know, so this one said she came in alone and would do this alone. But they also had that perception that there were no opportunities for second chances. So forms of capital that they had access to in the process of adapting to UCT. So if you participated in sports, it was easier to make friends. The dining hall was identified as a space where you could meet people who would speak your language and ultimately became your friends. And then from an academic perspective, it was spaces where they were working in small groups, so PBL, quantitative literacy. So they started then regrouping there, studying together, go to church, and then the shoko. So it provided them an opportunity to sharpen their skills. So in looking at objective three, then this journey of becoming a healthcare professional. So this is now in a context of a habitus that is generative, capable, you know, of transforming and expanding. As I said, you know, you can twist it in any other way. So it happens at five levels. In the first levels, the scraps that were embedded earlier on, they became an armor because people were touching them, patients and also other healthcare professionals. So they felt safe wearing a scrap. They said it was a battle suit, but they could also be a professional when they wore their scrubs. There was also a shift from theory to practice. And in the third level, there was a shift from their approach to work. Primary healthcare centers became spaces for multidisciplinary work. And also they spoke of a shift where the approach to patient encounters was considered from a biopsychosocial and holistic patient management perspective. And they spoke of becoming health sciences professionals managing patients under supervision. So in those roles, classmates were supportive, and there was also a realization that their studies required a multidisciplinary approach. So I'm just going to flip through my slides then to show you how these five levels were accrued. So for instance, in the next one, they speak of the role of lecturers, the role modeling, the aspiration, and they also speak of the different levels, and the preclinical and the clinical, and also having access to someone who could be a good clinician, who's kind-hearted and friendly, and who applied evidence-based medicine. And then there was this ownership of patients, where in working with patients, they had a defined role. And in this case, the clinics were the best place, you know, for them to achieve this, work with patients, have a relationship with patients, but also have a relationship with other people as they were part of a multidisciplinary team. So they spoke of patients allowing them to have the confidence to manage their work, encouraging them to read up on conditions that they have encountered. And so when they had to leave, they were said that that relationship was terminated. But even with this, there were still disruptions, and institutional hierarchies were a problem. So they speak of hierarchies within the university, where if you are in health sciences, you are seen to be, you know, a better student, you have access to everything that is better. But then within the Faculty of Health Sciences, they speak of a hierarchy where, audiology is at the lower end of the scale and medicine is at the top. And one participant spoke of this hierarchy where, you know, if you are a Black woman, you are at the bottom of the bottom of the bottom. And I mean, as they explained that, that you have this one at the top, and they said that males were favored. And so in fact, they were at the upper league, even though they were also Black. There were issues of racism, which also interfered with the attainment of academic capital. So for instance, this one said, UCT is white, but the OT department is even whiter than UCT. And they felt that in those spaces, they were not committed enough, even though they had the knowledge, because their peers would take what was their knowledge and claim it as their own. But it was not only, you know, peers, practitioners, it was also patients. So there were patients who would refuse to work with Black students. So they had to draw from their social attributes in approaching patients who spoke their language or a language that they can communicate in. And this, in fact, allowed them to then translate their social attributes into professional attributes. But for some students, this was an ongoing challenge. So for instance, this one, she spoke of an experience where they were not taught. They were a group of four. One person was taught, it was a white male, and the others, they only had to put up drips. But in terms of their clinical knowledge, they were lacking, and in fact, this one had to write some. So their fears were that they may not be fit, you know, to do their internship because they were not fully prepared. But beyond that, they spoke of being a Black woman. Where in a particular discipline, registrars refused to support them, would not sign, their logbooks would not allow them to observe in theater. And yet we know that this is a space where they can learn and there's role modeling. But beyond that, with a habitus then that is generating and is developing, drawing from a relational habitus, that is from a history, historical experiences of who they were. So they learned to make this shift from being from being people-centered instead of being mark-centered. And in fact, they drew from their compassion from who they were as students of rural origin. And this, in fact, also allowed them to sign up as mentors because they said they understood the experiences of students of rural origin. They also acknowledged that there were people that they looked up to, you know, who had achieved, who they wanted to model, and whose character they wanted to embody. And so that was inspiring for them. So then in terms of this thesis, what came out was that there was, as a theory of practice, in objective four, this is where I present now, a relational multi-professional framework. So if you remember earlier on, I spoke about the field. So this is what you have in yellow, migrating from rural areas, the schools where they were taught, to urban areas. So in the Faculty of Health Sciences, for instance, we're talking about facilities in Cape Town, and then the clinical context that would include academic teaching complex and also a district health platform. And if you're looking at my arrows, the green arrows, they infer to a primary habitus. The yellow dotted arrows, they refer to negative experiences that I described earlier on. And so when these students of rural origin, when they joined UCT, they came in with a cultural capital, they had matric certificates, they had awards from debating, they were educated, they had an educated habitus, you know, they knew that you needed to greet, show respect, show care, compassion. They were teachers because they could teach Sunday school children. And coming in then with that educated habitus, they experienced the first disruptions. So this is where they had to put on scrubs or stethoscope or a white coat. But then, you know, because they had access to different spaces that I mentioned previously, church, friends, sport, their habitus could generate. But then at that point, they were also becoming familiar with the context, you know, the tone of their lecturers, they had support from their classmates, they also were supported in small group and spaces. And their habitus continued.
I just want to be quiet.
And
people who have, you know,
approaching, you know, the end of their training, they did experience another disruption.
Hi, Ntsiki. It seems that you are muted.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Because they have
somebody else was making a noise.
So. So then, in terms of, let me go back to slideshow. So in terms of the policy review that I'm suggesting, so if you recall earlier on, I said that only 7% of the students were through students of rural origin. The others were inappropriately classified as such based on their geographical location. And I'm also suggesting that we reconsider the WHO rural pipeline approach, because it assumes that if you introduce students of rural origin, it's fine, I'm unmuted. Thank you. So if you introduce students of rural origin to an institution, they will graduate as healthcare professionals and be able to practice in those spaces. But we know that that is not entirely true. So I'm suggesting a review of both policies. And in terms of my conclusion, so what I have presented are insights of how students of rural origin negotiate difficult university spaces. Their rural upbringing allows them to be vulnerable, but they are also resilient. And they have this interest motivation to succeed, that is, if they can. And their capital, their primary habitus, and the kinds of capital that they have access to generate desirable attributes, you know, because they are able then to translate social attributes into professional attributes, which accrue benefits for patients. So through this study, it was possible then to identify prevailing challenges and perception that rural areas are areas of deprivation. And I have highlighted inherent values and strength of rural communities that have been overlooked in previous studies. And those are some of my references. Thank you.
Wow, Ntsiki, thank you so much. Such an amazing, interesting presentation, a lot of work, a lot of great insights. We're going to open it up for comments and questions. Can I just ask if you got a sense of these rural students, whether their aspirations were, what their aspirations were for their practice? Because that was one of the things that people said, we've got to get rural students in so that we're going to have a sustainable rural workforce.
These students were, I would say, somewhat inspired. But they said that the Western Cape does not expose them to rural areas. So they do have, you know, some experience of that, but it's not enough to enforce, you know, that love for rural communities. But there was, this intrinsic motivation within them. So for instance, one spoke of a commitment, you know, to go back to her hometown. And she also wanted to open a business and support, you know, women in that particular area. But it was not enforced, you know, from an academic perspective.
You mean it wasn't reinforced in it?
Yes.
Feroz's hands up. Yes, I see. Feroz, do you want to unmute yourself and ask a question?
Thank you so much. It's actually more of a comment than a question. First, Ntsiki, this is a brilliant piece of work. It's so, so important for us to explore the experiences of the students to figure out how we can support them better in this environment. And very well done to you. One thing you mentioned that stood out for me is that the students that come from a rural background have resilience. And this is really fantastic, because there's this common perception that our students don't have resilience, and they put it down to a generational thing, which may or may not be a factor, but it's actually very comforting to know that that this is one of your findings, and that it's not all the students that don't have resilience, and in fact rurality may very well be the habitus that is providing a place for them to develop that resilience. So thank you.
Thanks, Feroza. And in fact, if you think about these experiences of, I mean, there were so many, you know, having to cross a river to get to school. It takes a lot, you know, you go in the one time, you have to try again. They also spoke of, so the one, for instance, said she lived in a mountainous area and there was no network. You know, you have to climb the tree to get a network. And you know, just for them to certify documents, you know, it meant that they had to take a taxi and another taxi and another taxi because there was no bank in the area in which they were residing. So there were a lot of challenges and I mean, unique experiences that pertained to the participants.
Itu.
Thanks, Ntsiki. This was a very amazing presentation. I think for me, my question is in two parts. What do we take from the study in relation to our admissions criteria? I know we were the faculty board discussing issues around admissions of students and what does it mean? You know, what do the findings mean in terms of the kinds of learners that we should be aiming for and the type of support that we should be providing for those learners to be able to access the university? And then secondly, once they are here, what in this faculty should we be doing to support students a bit better? And I think we've talked about it before, but if you thought more about it in terms of do we identify all students of rural origin and you know, give targeted support to them all? Do we just let everybody go in and see and just allow them to get ask for support? You know? Yeah, so one for admissions and one for support when we come.
So there should be intentional recruiting where one is targeting, you know, those students who have the right results. When I say the right results, I mean for the faculty and its intention. So they must meet the criteria. I personally do not subscribe in bringing in students who have not attained the right standard. So that should be the first thing. But as we do that, we need to ensure that they are supported from day one, you know, so that they open the right doors. The challenge is in the time they lose, trying to find, you know, the right instrument, the right place, open the right door. Because remember that their tone does not allow them to participate fully. You know, they don't trust themselves, you know, to speak to you and ask a question. So in class, they keep quiet. You know, because they don't trust their voices, they think that somebody is going to laugh at them. And in fact, in the extreme, one participant said that she stayed away from classes for 2 years, you know, because she was trying to find her own rhythm. And the one thing about these participants is that they come from spaces where they were high achievers from, you know, grade not up to grade 12. But the context is a context where they did everything in Zulu, or Isiswane or whatever. And so English is in fact the challenge. It's not their academic potential, it's the English, the fact that the language of instruction is English. So if we decolonize our curriculum and create spaces, you know, for them to find their voices and in speaking their language and be able to present what they understand about health and communities from their own perspective, they will be able to find themselves. I mean, from the work that I did with students at VETS, in fact, often what you find beyond second year, they are able to thrive on their own with no support. Yeah, it's really just the adjustment, you know, because they are adjusting to, you know, to the institution, they are adjusting to a context that is different, they are adjusting, you know, culturally and linguistically. And so it's many, many changes. And in fact, students say that they speak of adjusting also to residences, you know, where the food is different. They speak about that in this study, you know, because they are used to certain meals, certain combinations. And so even that is confronting. Yeah. And the fact that sometimes they struggle to find the right church, you know, so there's no sense of belonging. They say it takes about 6 months, you know, just to find yourself. But then to find your voice in your classroom, in a classroom setting, it takes about 4 years. But of course, it's variable depending on what you're exposed to.
If I just add committee of the vision is just, as you're talking, something that rang in my head is my own experience of first year when, if I think of orientation week, the issue of English is all I heard. And I came at, after your presentation, I thought, would it have been different if there was a registrar specialist in MO, which he came and spoke in my own language in that week? And, you know, would it have helped just get a sense of, so there are people like me here who I can hear and who I can understand and who I can possibly approach? Could there have been somebody who speaks Zulu or Xhosa in that week to actually say, UCT is not far? We are here, maybe in the world somewhere, but we're here for you. It's just a very simple way in which one can be made to feel that, you know, that the environment is welcoming to you as well, instead of just a list of saying, here are mentors, here are people who will see them.
But remember that the disorientation extends into the clinical space.
Yes.
So you have patients, you know, who reject them on the basis of who they are. So it does not end there. And but then we also have then the registrars and other practitioners who place them in delegated roles. You know that you can only do this, you can only perform here. And so that is an additional challenge and one that they are not expecting. You know, because they consider themselves to be part of the system. And if you're looking at that, it also now has financial implications and practice implications because you cannot then say a UCT graduate is a safe graduate, you know, if they have had variable experiences. So we need then to be looking into that, ensuring that students have similar experiences, whether, you know, they are black, white, or colored, or otherwise.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Ntsiki. Every time you presented, I'm hearing something new, and it's lovely to go through it again. I'm very familiar with your data. But I'm thinking that you have studied the ones who've made it.
Yes.
And we haven't said anything about the ones who have been excluded. They've been excluded by our admission criteria and the assumptions that we make that everybody must get to an NBT center. Everyone must submit their applications online. You know, and the digital divide is very real in this country, specifically in rural areas. And then the few that do make it hit that first disruption, that, as you've described so well. You know, that, this is a very unfriendly place. I mean, everyone has to make an adjustment from high school to university, everybody. Even those who've grown up in Cape Town or whatever, you have to adjust. But this adjustment is extreme. And that's the point I think you're making very clearly, that we need to mitigate that. And what is fascinating, and I don't know that you emphasize it enough, is how they find themselves in the clinical years.
Yes.
Because suddenly they realize, oh, this is a relational thing. Okay, this is not just like science, you know, objective science. There's people here. I know how to speak to Cole. I can speak to her actually in my language, and I'm ahead of my white classmates who can't speak the language. And suddenly there's this kind of, okay, we can fit into this system. And I just found that absolutely fascinating and encouraging, I suppose.
Yeah. And in fact, that's how they find themselves in the system. It's because they then create their own patient base. And those patients, in fact, are in favor in that, you know, they take their time with them because they say it's the same as speaking to my mother or someone that I can relate to. And they are interested in patient outcomes. So it's not just about that initial encounter. They also consider what will happen when they go back home. You know, will they have the resources? If they're saying, you must do this exercise, will they have access to that? Can they present them with an alternative? So this is, so their version of a holistic and biopsychosocial approach is not necessarily, you know, the one that is prescribed in text. It's their own version. Based on their understanding of the patient and the environments in which they're going into.
I just want to ask about, you said, did most of the people that you interviewed, including the health and rehab students, intend to do medicine? Is that what their first intentions? Because you indicated that there was something around that. So I'm really curious about that.
Yeah, so it is in our roles, somewhere, in how we present information, there's an expectation that you can you know, you can apply for medicine. If you don't get in, you will get a second opportunity. You know, so there were students who went into second year still hopeful, you know, that they might get into medicine. But then with time, they, you know, as they were getting socialized into their programs, into their degrees, they learned, you know, to love what they had registered for. But it was not their intention. Many of them thought they would get into medicine, you know, based on their results, their aspiration, and also, you know, their vision. I mean, I think the exceptions, yeah, there were a few exceptions. So one, for instance, was had an encounter with a child who had Down syndrome. And another one was this one whose father was diabetic and said that, you know, you have healing hands. It was, she used to massage the father.
It's just interesting because some of the admissions criteria that's been proposed is that preference is given to students who want to do health and rehab as their first choice, and we should not admit, well, we not should not give preference to people who have it sort of as their second choice. And then should be, and then, you know, if, it's just something to think about, particularly for rural students, because they possibly have never been exposed to other rehab things, so their expectation is to do medicine and their desire is to do that. And then how, what do we do with that? Because then we're going to disadvantage people possibly in the future. So that's a little bit of a concern. And the other thing I wanted to ask is, what do you think about first-year students, particularly those from outside of Cape Town, rural, or to be obliged to stay in arrears in their first year? In order for them, that they should be the priority for resident students, so that and a whole program gets curated around them. You know, this is what is what happens in many universities around the world. All first year students, they have to stay in grades in many of these programs. And honestly, I see the logic, particularly in the view of your data.
It is a protective factor, and in fact, so I mean, I'm not quite sure if UCT has reached that point as yet, but I know that that's now prioritizes first years. But I mean, as they do that, you know, it also presents a challenge to the other students, you know, because some of them are not ready. They're not mature enough to leave the residences. So it is a bit of a dilemma. And I mean, we know that accommodation is a challenge. You know, once you outsource accommodation, it means that you are at the mercy of the landlord, you know. Somebody can present something on paper, but then the reality could be something else. But yeah, I mean, it's one of the protective. So there's, in fact, three protective factors. There's it's accommodation, it's tuition, and it's books, access to books. So if you're looking at that student, she had none of those. No books, no accommodation, no, everything was just negative.
I think we've come to the end of the session. Thanks everybody for being online, and thanks to the small group that we have here. Ntsiki, we are so delighted that you've done this work, and we're so looking forward to seeing some changes and some recommendations, some of your recommendations being implemented into the future. So thank you so much.
Thanks to the people who are online, who joined online. I'm sorry about the volume that went off. I'm not sure what happened with that, but thank you. So I don't know how I will get my results to the